Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we thank you, O God, for bringing us into the month of July. We exalt your name and we bless your name for a new and a fresh stamina in the spirit. The Bible says of the mouth of the prophet Habakkuk that, O God, you will renew us and you will perfect us. And in the midst of the years, O God, you will perfect that which you have spoken. We command the heavens to be open upon us as your people. And we declare, O God, that you will take us like you took Jeremiah, running with him, even in the tracks of the Jordan River, and making him to run with horses and chariots. And we declare, O God, like that, like the eagle, we will not be tired, will not be weak, and will not run out of energy and strength and steam. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus for giving us the grace to mount up with wings, even to begin to run and soar and move, even in the things of the Spirit of God. We declare that let every weak hands be strengthened. Let every feeble need even be made strong, because this is the season, O God, of our harvest. This is the season, O God, of our glory. This is the season, O God, of our power. We thank you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that as your word comes, O God, let your word come with fire. Let your word come with power. Let your glory even saturate us. And let your fire fill the whole place, O God. We give a praise. We give a glory. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We have come into the midst of the year. And Habakkuk said in Habakkuk chapter 3, that in the midst of the year, the Lord will perfect his work. The Lord will accomplish his work. And the Lord will do wonders. This is the seventh month of the year, which is the mid-year. And I'm excited, because as I look at what God has done for you and for me, in the midst of all these global challenges and difficulty, the Lord's grace has abounded. The Lord's mercies have been renewed. The Lord's goodness and the Lord's loving kindness have been amazing. We serve such an awesome God. Today, we are alive and we are part of the living. For David says, it is the living that praise God. And those who die or those who are dead cannot praise God. There is no praise. There is no testimony. There is no life in the grave. So as long as we live, we will give praise to our God. Hallelujah. This month is a month dedicated to relationships. So we have come into a season of relationship. I will be looking at all forms of relationship and how we can better our fortunes in relationship. And how we can become better believers in relationship. Today, I'm speaking on the topic, the genesis of relationship. The genesis of relationship. So go to the beginnings of relationship and the Lord will journey with us. And I know by the time we are done, we become better people and having a better relationship. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Hallelujah. All creation flows and function seamlessly in relationship. That is in union. All creation. God created all things for relationship. Whether they are celestial heavenly beings, whether they are oceanal or aquatic creatures, whether they are vegetational or zoological creatures, whether they are beings in the human family, whether they are biological things, whether they are insects, whether they are small creatures, whether they are flying birds, all that God created to relate. And no wonder there is no island when it comes to God's creation. For example, vegetation gives their oxygen to man. And man gives their carbon dioxide to vegetation. What a God. This God is a God who relates and is a God who creates. No wonder, even the creation story in the book of Genesis, we saw God speaking as a God who relates. And every time we hear God say, let us Let us to show that the whole of creation came into being on the basis and the foundation of relationship. Let's read the scriptures. In the beginning, God prepared, formed, fashioned, and created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and empty waste, and darkness was upon the face of the very great deep. The Spirit of God was moving, hovering, brooding over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be illumination. Let there be light. Let there be clearness. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, suitable, pleasant. And he approved of it. And God separated the light from the darkness. I even took it to verse 4. May God bless his word. Relationship is the hub or the fulcrum that regulates all creation. When I was very little, I used to love to ride bicycle. And when you look at a bicycle, the tire, there are what we call spokes. Those little hundreds of spokes. They are connected to around this thing we call the hub. And they are connected to it. And we have things in it that actually facilitate the movement of the tire. And that's how the whole bicycle even moves or functions in mobility. So without a hub, there's no movement. So relationship is like the hub in a bicycle that facilitates movement. Relationship is like a fulcrum or a pivot upon which everything in creation is regulated, without which nothing will work. In other words, relationship is key. Relationship is the key that causes creation to move. Misunderstanding and misapplication of relationship has been the cause of our chaotic world. The misunderstanding and misapplication of relationship has been the cause of the chaotic world we see today. God saw chaotic world by relationship, through relationship with the Godhead. God changed everything. And God fixed the world and brought it back to function in relationship. But we humans have taken the world back into the days before God came to create. Until God becomes the foundation and the founder of our relationships, we will only reproduce dysfunctional relationships. Let me repeat that. Until God becomes the foundation and the founder of our relationships, we will only reproduce dysfunctional relationships. The Bible says, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? So every relationship must be founded on God himself. Every relationship must have God as the founder and the leader. In Hebrews chapter 11 verse 10, when the Lord had asked Abraham to leave, the Bible said Abraham was looking for a city with a foundation whose builder, whose architect was God himself. Because Abraham understood that from where he was coming from, there was a dysfunctionality from reality. So he looked for a city with a foundation whose architect is God. Today, I believe that God himself is bringing back his word to himself, where he will reestablish himself as a foundation and the founder of all our relationship. And when God becomes the foundation and the founder of our relationship, our world will become better. What is relationship? What is relationship? Merriam-Webster's dictionary says, relationship is a state of being related or interrelated. Relationship is being related or interrelated. The same dictionary says, relationship is a passionate attachment or closeness. A passionate attachment or closeness. I define relationship. So this is the Shamosin definition. So relationship is a defined, determined, and dear commitment to a divine being or other beings. That is what relationship is. So let's look at verse 1 of Genesis 1. The principles we find, or I find in Genesis 1 verse 1, is that God is the beginning of all relationships. God is the beginning of all relationships. When I check the meaning of beginning in the Hebrew, it tells me the first in place, the first in time, the first in order, the first in rank, specifically a first fruit. Beginning, the chief or the chiefest, the principal, the first fruit, the first part, the first time. What it means is very simple. That God is the first. God is the chiefest. God is the principal when we come to the school of relationship. So when it comes to relationship, God is the first in relationship, in place, in time, in order, in rank, or in priority. God is the principal of relationship. So none of us can relate without first of all getting our relationship started in God. I cannot properly relate to any man or any woman without first of all beginning my relationship with God. And a lot of people have entered into relationships and they're not able to sustain it because they do not have relationship with the one who is the foundation of all relationships. Whether it is a corporate relationship, whether it is a mutual relationship, whether it is a family relationship, whether it is a relationship that will lead to marriage, whether it is a relationship that is spousal, whatever relationship it is, we must understand that the individuals in a relationship must first of all establish a relationship with the Creator himself. Because without a relationship, a proper functioning relationship with the Creator, any other relationship will end up dysfunctional or being a dysfunctional relationship. So people start to relate. People do well to relate, but they get to the middle of their relationship and the thing becomes so dysfunctional. Somebody will say to me, "My pastor, we have many people in the church who have started relationships and the relationship has become very sour. The relationship has become very dysfunctional. Why is it so?" It is so because their foundation was not properly rooted in God, who is the foundation, who is the beginning, who is the first in order, in time of relationship. If we do have a functional relationship with God, then all other relationships will align. All our dysfunctional relationships will be healed and God will be glorified. Say hallelujah. I want us to look at the four major types of relationship that I have put together. The first one is what I call the upper relationship. The upper relationship. I remember in some of my teachings, I've talked about relationship, especially when we're talking about prayer. We're talking about God being our Father. And having a relationship with the Father, I taught this principle. But I'm repeating it here because this is a month of relationship. So we have what I call the APRA, APRA, the APRA. I'm referring to a relationship with divinity. I'm talking about a relationship above. And I put that one first because that is where everything should start. Anything that is sustained in the physical must begin and be sustained in the spirit. So we have upper relationship with divinity. We have it with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, the triune God. The second form or type of relationship is what I call the intra-relationship. The intra-relationship is a personal relationship. It has to do with a relationship with yourself. A lot of people love to relate to God and they do well, but they cannot relate to themselves. But God requires that we relate to ourselves. We relate to our own spirit, taking care of our spirit. We will let to our soul, taking care of our mind, our emotions, and our will. And we will let to our body and the systems of our body. It's very important. The third relationship is what I call the interrelationship. Relationship with other people. Relationship with other men. Relationship with other women. Relationship with people. And then the final one is what I call the envra. Envra relationship. And envra relationship has to do with a relationship even with your environment. A lot of us do not understand why God places certain things in the environment. Why you go and meet a tree in a particular place or set of trees. We just cut them down because we don't understand. We don't even know their essence, their use. We don't know why God put them there. But if we understand that those things that we meet, the hills, the mountains, even the water bodies, the vegetation, and all the animals and the things we see, if we understand that they are part of our relationship, we'll know how to manage them very well. So this is what I call the four basic relationship structure, and they must flow. So apra, first, intra, second, inter, third, and envra, fourth. All these things must follow their order. The question is, how do you relate to someone that you do not know? So the question is, who is God and how do we know him? Jesus said to the woman at the well of Samaria, the woman at Jacob's well, he said, for you Samaritans do not know whom you worship, but we the Jews, we know. That is where salvation belongs to us. And I keep asking myself the question, if God appears to you tomorrow, would you identify him as God? If Jesus show up to you, even in a bus station, in the taxi, in a train, even along the street, or somewhere, somehow, would you be able to identify him? Three men came to the house of Abraham, and Abraham could identify that God was there, because God is his friend, so he knows him. Eight things that you need to know quickly. We must know God as our creator. We must know God as our redeemer. We must know God as our husband. That is within the covenant. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah 54, verse 4 and 5, it says, behold, the Lord thy God is thy husband. So we need to know God within the context of covenant. Number four, God is our warrior. Exodus chapter 15, verse 3. It says, the Lord is a man of war, and the Lord is his name. Hallelujah. Number five, we must know God as our Father. He is our Father. He birthed us. He gave birth to us by right of creation, by right of bringing us into being. God has become our Father. We need to know all these things about God in order to relate to him. Number six, God is our executive. God is our judge or our judiciary. God is our judiciary. We must also know that God is our legislature. Isaiah 33 verse 22. It says, the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our king. And the Lord is our lawgiver. And he will save us. So this is what I call the three arm of government of God. And we should know him as such. When we know him, we'll be able to relate to him. Hallelujah. Not knowing God will prevent us from relating to him. Not knowing God will prevent us from relating to him. In Exodus chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, God asked Moses to go and tell Pharaoh, Pharaoh, let my people go that they may serve me. Pharaoh said, who is this Lord? I do not know him, and I'll not let Israel go. Once you do not know this God, you'll not be able to relate to him. And Pharaoh demonstrated it. The knowledge of the triune God is progressive and dynamic. The knowledge of God is progressive and dynamic. Yesterday you knew him. Today you got to know him. Tomorrow we got to continue to know him. Hosea chapter 6, verse 1 to 3, but verse 3 in particular, the Bible says, let us pursue and progressively know the Lord. It means that we cannot know everything about God. We know him in part. On a daily basis, we know God, and we're going to learn to discover him as we relate to him. Hallelujah. Amen. God revealed himself to Abraham in many ways. In Genesis chapter 12, Abraham saw God in a different way. Chapter 13, 14, and 15, he saw God in a different way. In chapter 17, God appeared to him as El Shaddai, the God who walks in covenant. In chapter 18, Abraham met God and saw him as a friend. And all these things were progressive about him. In chapter 19, chapter 20, even up to 22, Abraham began to rediscover other aspects of God. God has many chambers. God is a mystery. The more we relate to him, the more we get to know him. The more we press into him, the more he shows us things. Hallelujah. The next question I want to ask, what are the channels God uses to reveal himself? There are seven basic channels. There are seven basic channels God used to reveal himself. I'm still talking about the number one point. The number one point I raised, which has to do, God is the beginning of our relationship. We have three major points, but I'm still on the number one. What are the channels God uses to reveal himself? Seven basic channels, quickly. God revealed himself through his creation. Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament is praise. Day after day, they pour speech and they utter knowledge. Romans chapter 1, verses 9 to 20. God said to the people through Paul that he, God, has revealed himself through his creation. Romans chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. He said, those who do not believe him, he has even made himself known. The invisible God has made himself visible in his creation. So no man has an excuse. Hallelujah. Number two, God revealed himself through his word. God revealed himself through his word in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 19. In John chapter 5, verse 39. 1 Samuel chapter 3, 19. And John chapter 5, verse 39. And then 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 7. All these things speak to the fact that God had to reveal himself through his word to the later young prophet in the making, Samuel, through his word. When Samuel didn't know the word, when God called him, he went and ran to a man. And that has become the challenge you and I have been having. When God is speaking, we think he's our mind. When God is speaking, we think he's man. Number three, God revealed himself through his prophets. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 1. The Bible says God at sundry times revealed himself through his prophets, his servants. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 5. God revealed himself through his apostles, the prophets. Ephesians 3, 5. Number four, God revealed himself through circumstances and situation. Job chapter 42, verses 1 to 6. Sometimes God will allow difficult challenges, difficult conditions, in order for him to reveal himself to us. For Job said in Job 42, 1 to 6, Job said, I only heard the Lord with my ear. But in my challenges and my difficulty, my eyes have beheld him. My brother, my sister, maybe the reason why the Lord has allowed that challenge, that circumstance, that situation, is that God wants to reveal himself to you in a different way, in another way. Say hallelujah. Number five, God revealed himself through personal encounters. Through personal encounters. Genesis chapter 20, verse 1 to 3. The Lord came to King Abimelech when he took Sarah because Abraham lied that he was a sister. The Bible said, in the evening, the Lord appeared or came to Abimelech in his bedroom. So sometimes God will reveal himself even on the personal note, personal encounter. Number six, God revealed himself through humanity. God can also reveal himself through humanity. Psalm 8, verse 1 and 2, the Bible said, the heavens declare God's glory, and even the glory of God is established upon the earth. And then they say, who is man, or what is man, that thou art mindful of him? Psalm 8. Thou hast made man a little lower than Elohim. So sometimes God will use humanity to reveal himself unto his people. Hallelujah. Oh, I say hallelujah. Number seven, God uses Christ, Jesus Christ, even to reveal himself. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. When God has so many times used prophets to reveal himself, he said, but now the Lord is speaking through Jesus, his son, unto us. And that is what God is doing. Now let's go to verse 2 of Genesis chapter 1 quickly. In verse 2, the principle here is that God does not only relate to people and things that are perfect. In other words, we must understand that in our relationships, there are imperfect situations. There are imperfect people. When God made creation, creation was at no form. Creation was void and empty. And creation was filled with darkness. Sometimes we don't want to relate to people and places and persons because they don't fit into a description of perfection. But when God came to relate to his creation, creation was so imperfect. So we need to understand that God, when he relates, he does not only relate to perfect people, perfect situation, and perfect condition. But God comes with his perfection in order to change the environment, to change the place and make an impact and affect the people. Verse 3, number 3 point. God is light, and therefore we can only relate to him in the light. God said when he made his creation, let there be light. God is light. Verse 3, number 3. And therefore we can only relate to him in the light. God said, let there be light. The word light means illumination. Illumination, revelation, insight, that which is uncovered and lifted. In 1 John 1:5, 1 John 1:5, it says that we can only relate to God in light. So when we fellowship with one another, then God shares his light upon us. In Revelation 21:23, it says Jesus became the light of the new Jerusalem, or the heavenly Jerusalem. In 1 John chapter 1 verse 7, it says that when we confess our sins and all that, the light of God shines upon us. So for us to be able to relate, even like God, and relate to people, my brothers and sisters, I want us to understand that this is how God related. He's the foundation of our relationships. And God does not only relate to people and situations in perfection. And God relate in the light. In other words, for me to relate to you and you relate to me, and we need to do that on the basis of revelation. I need to know you for who you are. You need to know me for who I am in the sight of God, in the presence of God. And our relationship can be so fluid, our relationship can become so wonderful. That doesn't mean we may not have challenges. We may and we will do. But once I know who you are, and you know who I am in the spirit and before the Lord, then we can relate properly. The Bible said, henceforth, know no man after the flesh, but the spirit. We have the challenges because we only relate on the basis of the flesh. May God bless his word and bless us who hear. And as we begin this new sessions and series and times with God in the month of July, a month dedicated to relationships, God will bring us nuggets. God will bring us data, information. God will bring us revelation on relationships that will change our dynamics, become better people, and begin to relate like God. God bless you. I love you. And mega shalom. I'll see you again with another powerful message on relationship. Please don't miss this month, and don't miss this series, and don't miss this moment, and don't miss these messages on relationship. Shalom. I'll see you soon in Jesus' name. Amen.